In the previous part, we derived the element-wise expression of the Bellman equation. Now let's discuss its matrix vector form. Once we have a Bellman equation, we need to solve it. As you can see, this is the expression of the Bellman equation we have derived. The left-hand side contains one state value and the right side contains another state value. From this single equation, it is impossible to calculate the state value directly. However, we notice that this element-wise form is valid for every state. If I have n states, then I will have n equations like this. If we put all the equations together, we have a set of linear equations that can be concisely written in a matrix vector form, which is very elegant and important. It can greatly help us understand the topic. Let's now see how to derive the matrix vector form. First, this is the Bellman equation that we have just derived. We rewrite it by combining this term with this term, resulting in r pi s, which represents the average immediate reward I can receive starting from the current state as shown below. Then, by combining this term with this term, we obtain this p pi, which is the probability from s to s prime, as shown below. Therefore, through this process, we derive an expression that simplifies the previous one. Furthermore, to represent it in matrix vector form, we need to combine all states together. Then we need to assign labels to different states because using just s to represent them can lead to confusion about which state corresponds to which s. So we label them as s1, s2, all the way up to sn, assuming we have n states. Therefore, the equation becomes this. The state value of si equals the first term, which is the average immediate reward, followed by the probability of jumping from ESI to SJ, and the state value V pi SJ. Transforming this equation into a matrix vector form is simple. Here, V pi is a vector, which is represented as follows. V pi equals from V pi S1 to V pi SN. Similarly, R pi is also a vector, represented in this form. P pi might be a bit more complex, but we can see it more clearly through an example. P pi ij with brackets and subscripts ij indicates the element at row y and column j, which is the probability of transitioning from si to sj. P pi, this matrix, is also known as the state transition matrix. We can examine this through an example. In this example, I have n states with n equal to 4. The matrix vector form looks like this in this case. The first term is quite intuitive, and this term are quite intuitive too. This term demonstrates quite well what a state transition matrix is. Let's look at its first row as an example, though any row could work similarly. For the first row, the first element represents the probability of transitioning from S1 to S1. The second element represents the probability of transitioning from S1 to S2. The third element represents the probability of transitioning from S1 to S3. And the fourth element represents the probability of transitioning from S1 to S4. Let's use an example to further illustrate the concept. Consider this scenario with a policy pi, which is depicted with green arrows. Our task now is to write out its Bellman equation and matrix vector form. First, we have a vector form of state value on both sides. This is a vector for r pi. What is the first element of r pi? It represents the average immediate reward obtained from starting at S1. Starting from S1, the immediate reward is deterministic, resulting in 0. Similarly, starting from S2, S3, and S4, the immediate rewards are all 1. Now, let's look at p pi, and this is p pi. For example, consider the first row. The first element represents the probability of transitioning from S1 to S1, which is 0. The second element represents the probability of transitioning from S1 to S2, also 0. The third is the probability of transitioning from S1 to S3, which is 1. The fourth is the probability of transitioning from S1 to S4, which is 0. The other rows can be written out similarly. Next, let's examine another slightly more complex example. Here, there's a possibility of moving to the right and also a possibility of moving downward. The focus is on how to write out r pi and p pi. Looking at the first element of r pi, starting from S1, what is the immediate reward? It's a combination of a 0.5 probability of moving right, resulting in negative 1, plus a 0.5 probability of moving down, which is 0. This is the average immediate reward obtained from starting at S1. looking at pi. Again, using the first row as an example. The first element represents the probability of transitioning from S1 to S1, which is 0. The second element is the probability of transitioning from S1 to S2, which, unlike before, now has a possibility of 0.5. The third element for transitioning from S1 to S3 is also 0.5. Transitioning from S1 to S4 is 0. Other rows can be written in a similar manner. Just now, we derived the matrix vector form of the Bellman equation. Next, let's use this matrix vector form to solve state values. First, let's address a critical question. Why solve state values? Given a policy, we can list the Bellman equations and then solve the equations to obtain state values. This process is called policy evaluation, which we have mentioned previously and now formally introduced. Policy evaluation is a fundamental problem in reinforcement learning because it allows us to tell whether a policy is good or bad. Only then can we improve it and ultimately find the optimal policy. Therefore, it is important to understand how to solve the Bellman equation. Here is the matrix vector form of the Bellman equation we've derived. Next, we present two methods for solving it. The first method is a closed-form solution, which directly provides an analytical expression for state values, like this. How do we get this solution? It's quite simple, and I encourage you to derive it on your own. Essentially, you can move this term to the left-hand side, and then apply the inverse of a matrix to get the solution. This closed-form solution has an elegant expression, but it's not typically used in practice because it requires calculating a matrix inverse. When the state space is large, the dimensionality of the matrix also becomes large, making the computation of the inverse quite demanding. Then we can use an iterative solution. The iterative solution is an equation like this. It is similar to the Bellman equation, with the difference being that vπ is replaced by vk on this side and by vk plus 1 on this side. How do we use this algorithm? First, here is vk, and here is vk plus 1. From step 0, we can make any arbitrary guess about what vπ equals, such as setting all values to 0. Then, by substituting vk into the right-hand side of the equation, we can calculate v1 on the left-hand side since all these values are known beforehand. Subsequently, substituting v1 back into the right-hand side allows us to calculate v2 on the left-hand side, and substituting v2 back into the right-hand side allows us to calculate v3 on the left-hand side, and so on. This process continues, yielding a sequence of v0, v1, v2, all the way to vk. In fact, it can be proven that as k approaches infinity, vk converges to vπ, where vπ represents the true state value. Why does vk converge to vπ? There's a proof for this. You can find it in my book. The basic idea involves defining the error or discrepancy delta k between vk and vπ. Ultimately, it can be shown that delta k converges to 0. Now let's look at a few examples. In this example, the rewards are as follows. Attempting to cross the boundary or entering the forbidden area results in a negative 1 reward, while reaching the target area grants a positive reward of plus 1. The discount factor gamma is set to 0.9. First, let's consider two relatively good policies. For instance, this one. Why is this policy considered good? Intuitively, it does not attempt to cross boundaries or walls and does not enter the forbidden area. Starting from this point and following this policy would lead directly to the target area. The state values calculated using either the analytical expression or the iterative algorithm are all positive. An interesting observation, which we'll analyze further, is that the state values are higher for locations closer to the target area and lower for those farther away. Let's consider another policy, which is nearly identical to the previous one except for different actions in these two cells. The first moves down, while this one moves right. But they yield the same state values, indicating that moving down or right in these cells has the same outcome. Different policies can lead to the same state values. After considering two good policies, let's examine two bad policies. The first policy involves moving right in every state, clearly unreasonable, resulting in entirely negative state values. This indicates that this policy is bad. This is a randomly generated policy whose actions often lead to collisions with walls or entry into the forbidden area. It is intuitively a bad policy. The calculated state values align with our intuition. Through these examples, we can clearly see that calculating state values allows us to effectively evaluate whether a policy is good or bad.